You will then listen to the audiobook, The Traitor of Prague, by H.L. Guerra, from Saturn Publishing House, Stockholm, Sweden. Narration generated by Saturn Group Audiobooks. Copyright, Saturn Publishing House, 2024. Chapter 1, November 25th. Prague, November 25th in the afternoon. The afternoon had fallen when Javier Puig prepared to leave the small hotel where he had stayed hours before. Passing through the reception desk, he picked up the American passport in the name of Rigoberto Sanchez, with which he was traveling on that occasion. And after exchanging a few German marks, he headed for the exit, mechanically counting the tattered and faded Czech crowns handed to him by the taciturn cashier. The sky was a whitish-gray color, with low, compact clouds that presaged snow. At the door, he had to step aside to avoid bumping into two individuals who, impetuous and somewhat disoriented, entered the hotel. He put the exchanged money in his wallet, following the two men who, in German with a strong Berlin accent, were arguing vehemently about the future of the battered Czechoslovakian communist regime, while the doorman, with a ruddy face and irascible look, took the suitcases out of the luggage compartment of the Mercedes 300 with West Berlin license plate in which they had arrived. Arriving at the reception desk, the younger one, placing one of his Nikon cameras on the counter as if it were a firearm, asked the receptionist, with a disdainful and absent air, for a reservation in the name of a certain Braun. The woman, petite and with an immutable expression, after consulting with the imperturbable parsimony of a socialist bureaucrat the man handled reservation book, kindly but firmly replied in slow German, with a strong Slavic accent, that there was no reservation with that name. The story only gained credibility when the other man, of jovial and licentious appearance, pressed a 20-mark bill in the palm of the hand of the pale and lanky woman with long ashen hair, who, without moving a single muscle of her face, when she checked the reservation book again, confirmed it. Javier kept watching them out of the corner of his eye, pretending to look worriedly at a poster located at the entrance on which a group of chorus girls were showing off their erect and massive breasts announcing the Great Alhambra Musical Review. The poster, inexplicably, was still in the lobby, even though the show had been canceled due to the political events shaking the country. The two Germans, once they had checked in at the registration book, after handing over their passports and receiving the room key from the aseptic receptionist, resumed the discussion about the future of Czechoslovakia, closely followed by the hotel bellboy, who, stumbling with the luggage at his back in a terrible English mixed with some German and Italian, began to offer them as they approached the old elevator a rosary of services, from an advantageous black exchange of marks to crowns, to the discreet company of wonderful girls or boys, if that's what the gentlemen were looking for, always at the best prices in Prague and with the greatest discretion in the world. Javier smiled inwardly as he listened again to the same nonsense he had heard from the bellboy himself hours before. The hotel was located near St. Wenceslas Square, in the very center of Prague. Knowing that he had a few hours in his favor, Javier walked quickly in the direction of St. Wenceslas Square, attracted by the shouts of more than 300,000 Czechs who demanded the resignation of the Central Committee and of Prime Minister Milos Jakes. Prague was in ferment, and a kind of organized, prudent, but unforeseen chaos reigned. Hours earlier, his arrival at Prague's International Airport had been chaotic. 100 Western journalists and photographers had elbowed their way through customs and passport control with him, under the astonished gaze of the regime's guards who, surprised by the human avalanche and convinced that the communist government, which they had preserved, did not have many hours of life left, let them pass without even checking their press credentials and passports. Still holding his passport, Javier was catapulted by the mob. The horde of journalists that dragged him, hungry for transcendental events with which to fill the television news or the front pages of their newspapers, boarded the few old cabs that remained. Other private cars, in exchange for a few German marks, offered to take them to the city as well. Javier managed to take one of those improvised cabs with a couple of Italian journalists who talked to him as if he were one of them. Czechoslovakia had become front-page news in those convulsive last months of 1989. Javier pulled the collar of his trench coat closed, surprised by a blast of cold air as he rounded the first corner. The joy, restrained only by the fear of the troops quartered 300 feet from the square, in the barracks at 32 Skulska Street, began to produce outbursts of rebellion among the students, despite the repression of the previous days. In the last 2 years, his brown hair had grayed rapidly, and his face had taken on that expression of resignation that men who have come to the conclusion that they will never become what they had imagined in their youth often take on. As he walked, he swung his long, lanky body forward, something that gave him a distracted appearance. 10 years it took for Poland, 10 months for Hungary, 10 weeks for the GDR, and 10 days for Czechoslovakia. He read on one of the banners carried by a group of students who passed him singing and laughing as if it were carnival. He stared at them, remembering times gone by. It began to snow. If there was one thing he really hated, it was precisely that kind of fine snow, which, when it froze, turned into lacerating ice pins that pierced his face. Irritated, he pulled up the collar of his raincoat, seeking protection among the canopies of the old buildings. The spy van belonging to the Special Intelligence Collection Group, as they called the operational commandos composed of CIA and National Security Agency, NSA personnel, working abroad in those years dedicated to ELINT, electronic intelligence, had been watching the apartment of Major Mario Paredes for several days. A small, chubby, round-faced individual with the expression of a big boy who, under the diplomatic cover of Second Secretary of the Cuban Embassy in Prague, held the position of Second Chief of Operations of the Cuban General Directorate of Intelligence DGI in Czechoslovakia. What in Cuban intelligence jargon was known as the Prague Legal Center, CLP. Inside the vehicle, Ray, the data collector technician, rubbed his hands together to relieve himself of the cold that was insistently seeping through the body of the vehicle before readjusting the transmitters. The area where Paredes' apartment was located was typical of Prague's suburbs, with long, gloomy 4 or 5 story buildings built in the 1960s, crowded around small, shady playgrounds in which children were never seen playing. The color of the walls had long since disappeared. From time to time, the occasional trolleybus would stop at the lonely stop where years ago, a socialist volunteer work brigade had planted some trees that had not withstood social erosion either. The apartment was small, and although far from the average standard of a Western European apartment, it was well furnished and had all the amenities that in Cuba were reserved for members of the nomenclatura. The number 2 of Cuban intelligence in Prague finished his coffee and quickly lit up, with a confident gesture, an export ligaros. He inhaled the strong and aromatic smoke of the Cuban cigarette, pocketing in his shirt pocket the navy blue pack with the drawing of the white sailboat. Major Paredes had been one of the first Cuban security officers to be personally trained in the early 1960s by KGB General Viktor Simonov, when the Soviet espionage organization created the DGI. From the beginning, Mario enjoyed the trust and friendship of General Simonov, who later became KGB Chief of Operations. His loyalty to Simonov had helped him to rise in Cuban intelligence, despite the purges that the Ministry of the Interior had undergone in those last 20 years. It was in 1987, when Paredes, for the third time during his years in the service of Cuban espionage, returned to Prague to occupy the high position of second in command of operations. His first mission in that city had been in 1964. He had just finished his training at the KGB Special School in Moscow. In the 1970s, he had returned for a short period before being sent to the Cuban Intelligence Center in Mexico. His exit from the building was immediately registered by the van's tracking equipment. He made his way to his Lada with diplomatic plates parked on a lonely side street. Walking through the streets of Prague, memories of the Soviet invasion of Czechoslovakia in October 1968 violently assaulted Javier. The shouts from St. Wenceslas Square merged in his memory with those of the young East German tankmen who, from the open turrets of their T-34s, 21 years earlier, claimed with ignorant vehemence that the West German revanchists had invaded Czechoslovakia. In endless columns, the tanks of the People's Army of the German Democratic Republic, hastily painted with the white stripe that identified them as an invading force of the Warsaw Pact, crossed the main street of Pirna. That small and picturesque town of East Saxon Germany, on the banks of the Elbe, where the invasion had surprised Javier in the arms of a young waitress who used to go to bed with foreigners, only to catch, for a few hours, part of a longed-for and unknown world, beyond the Berlin Wall. The armored vehicles continued their path of terror, passing through Hrensko, a small border crossing on the map of Europe, chosen by the Soviet military high command for its insignificance to introduce the East Germanic attack troops into Czechoslovakian territory. The deafening noise of the tanks continued to rumble in his head. He remembered the sweet, lonely girl staring in bewilderment through the small window overlooking the street at the shattering passage of the armored vehicles, gluing her naked, trembling body to his. "It is war. It's war." The repeated cries of a tank man, almost a child, erect in the turret of the tank, were finally confused with the multitudinous cries of freedom in the square. He walked through the streets of Prague, remembering the faces of the Soviet soldiers who were received in those same streets by the Czechs bare-chested, with no other weapons than persuasion, imprecation, and a few stones, and who days later, traumatized by the fact that they had been shooting with their tanks, not at the revanchist and capitalist enemy, but at a people who only wanted a socialism with more freedom, had to be replaced by other soldiers and these by others. It was the beginning of the end of communism in Eastern Europe, he thought. He came out of his memories arriving at St. Wenceslas Square, where the news had spread that the political bureau was finally resigning. The crowd cheered with disciplined joy for the man who 21 years earlier had legally tried to implement a democratic socialist regime, Alexander Dubček, the leader of the Prague Spring. "Dubček to the castle! Dubček to power!" shouted more than 300,000 throats. A scorching heat invaded his body. His eyes overflowed and he understood that he was crying. Those last 20 years had never really existed, he thought, and the maelstrom of history and memories transported him back to the days of the Prague Spring, when a similar crowd, in that same square, demanded socialism with a human face. Javier had lived close to that attempt to democratize communism in Czechoslovakia in 1968, and yet, in the midst of it all, he could not believe what he was experiencing. A strange déjà vu came over him. Dubček began to speak with his tired voice, mutilated by the long silence, from that famous balcony, next to a shy dissident writer and former political prisoner, who would later become the last president of Czechoslovakia and the first president of the Czech Republic, Václav Havel. The snow was melted by the human warmth that filled the square, and 300 feet away, Karel Urbanek, the new leader of the Czechoslovak Communist Party, elected in a hurry, declared in front of the television cameras that he did not know why or what he had been appointed for. The van's listening equipment, in agency jargon, Charlie Brown, stopped silently on Pariska Street, near the Jewish quarter, halfway between the old new synagogue and the offices of Cubana, Cuba's airline. Minutes later, after parking his Lada on a nearby street, Paredes entered the gloomy offices of the aviation company, closed that day due to the political events that were shaking the country, without turning on the light. "The bird is in the contact area," Ray said into the microphone. Minutes later, not far from there, on Breshova Street, which leads into the narrow triangle of the Ustarejo Herbitova, Javier got out of a cab, and after paying, headed with quick steps to the nearby Jewish cemetery from the middle of the 15th century. He entered through the small gate that serves as access to the cemetery and to the ceremonial hall, an adjoining early 20th century pseudo-Romanesque building, which serves as a permanent exhibition of drawings and texts by Jewish children imprisoned in the concentration camps of Hitler's Germany. The twilight of the evening gave the place an even more unreal aspect. The hundreds of tombstones piled on top of each other cast strange shadows on the snowy wall of the cemetery's east wing. He began to walk along the narrow path between the graves. Javier Puig also came to Prague for the first time in 1964 as second secretary of the Cuban embassy. The first time he visited that old Jewish cemetery, one of the oldest in Central Europe, had been that gray Sunday in September in the company of the same person as he now hoped to meet again in that same place, 25 years later, Mario Paredes. Many details were fading in his memory, others had remained intact in his recollection. The images preserved in his memory for years merged with the surroundings. Remembrance and reality suddenly acquired a new dimension and a new meaning. At that time, when he was not yet 23 years old, He had already completed expeditious diplomatic studies at the recently inaugurated school of the Cuban Ministry of Foreign Affairs, MINREX, after having completed intensive German studies in Leipzig. Those were the years when revolutionaries of homeland or death were needed in key positions, as Raúl Roa himself, then Minister of Foreign Affairs, had told him before he left Havana for Prague. On his first diplomatic mission, aboard the old Britannia of Cubana de Aviación, which, as usual, made its technical stopover in Gander. It had been at that Canadian airport, located on the distant island of Newfoundland, in the middle of a foggy night, waiting to return to the plane to continue his trip, when for the first time, far from his island, Javier dared to acknowledge, without any resentment, the doubts he had been accumulating towards that revolution he had sworn to defend so many times. Distance acted as a kind of balm on the wounds that had been opened during those last months of uncertainty and disenchantment by the excessive increase of repression and intolerance against those who in one way or another did not share, quite literally, the erratic political swings of the maximum leader, or simply did not harmonize with the official dogma of what a good revolutionary should be. The forced labor camps of the military units for aid to production, UMAP, where homosexuals, Jehovah's Witnesses, artists, writers, and anyone considered by the revolution as a social scourge, were the most palpable and aberrant proof of those violations. He took a deep breath and felt liberated, able to make his own decisions. Suddenly, he saw it all clearly. The course the revolution had taken was far removed from the libertarian ideals his father, a Catalan anarchist who had fled Spain in the middle of the Civil War to settle in Havana, where he married a Cuban woman, had instilled in him. The revolution has ceased to be what it was, or perhaps it never was. An illusion, at first spontaneous, now forced, he thought, looking around suspiciously to make sure that no one had heard the subversive murmur of his thoughts. It was then that he suddenly felt a sharp pang in the middle of his chest. His breathing shortened, and his heart began to beat faster. He felt a mad desire to flee, to desert, to leave everything, to run away. He felt afraid, but at the same time he began to feel free. He looked for the famous CIA agents, who, according to the mythology of the island's political police, were always lurking wherever there was a Cuban, in order to extract him or force him to defect. But there was no one in sight who could be a supposed enemy agent in that deserted airport at that late hour of the night. That man mopping the floor? No. A couple of stray Japanese with their cameras passed by. But Javier dismissed them as possible agents of imperialism as well. No, there was no one to confide that secret that he would have to carry as a burden from that moment on. Near him, the other Cubans, most of them men, who were traveling on the same flight, among whom there were state security agents, who as usual flew on Cuban planes to prevent desertions, attributed to what they euphemistically called imperialist provocations, looked at the electronic products on the shelves with dismay. But that first settling of accounts with himself, that attack of sincerity, of something he had thought many times but had refused to recognize, had suddenly turned him into an enemy of the regime, although he himself did not know it yet. That same night, on his way to Prague, he began to get out of the ideological quagmire in which he had found himself since Castro had abandoned the postulates of a humanist revolution, exchanging it for a communist regime that was becoming more and more unbearable and repressive every day. The fact that he had been sent to Prague at that time was a relief and a respite for him. It was also the first time he left Cuba, an experience he was going to make the most of. Hours later, in the tranquility of the plane, pretending to sleep, he felt again a mixture of fear and joy, aware that from that moment on, he would be an unknown person, also to himself. From then on, every time he swore loyalty to the commander-in-chief and his revolution, he would be lying, and he would have to pretend. He would have to convince others that he was telling the truth. Years later, when he interviewed other deserters and detractors of Castroism in the refugee camps in Miami, already working for the CIA, he understood very well when they tried to explain to him that they had lived for many years behind a mask. 25 years without returning to Prague, and it seems like yesterday. It's amazing how fast time goes by, Javier ruminated as he found his way among the tombs. the city continued to exert a strange magnetism on him, despite the time that had passed. It had been the first city in which he had lived outside Cuba, and despite the general atmosphere of frustration and isolation in which the great majority of Czechs lived at that time, the city had become an endearing and intimate place. When he was transferred at the beginning of 1968 to the dull and gray East Berlin, he continued to visit Prague as soon as the work at the Cuban embassy in Pankow allowed it. Walking for hours and hours through the old city, following in the footsteps of Kafka, or fraternizing with old friends between hugs, jokes, and mugs of black beer in the centenary brewery Ufleku. Suddenly Prague was again, as in 1968, on the brink of political change, this time more radical and profound. Once again, his destiny and that of the city crossed paths. The invasion of Czechoslovakia, which had surprised Javier in the small village of Pirna that summer of 1968, destroyed forever the utopia of building a communism with a human face. On his return to East Berlin, after that short vacation in that small East Saxon village on the banks of the Elbe, the decision he had made 4 years earlier, that night at the airport in Gander, and which had kept him awake at night more often than he would have liked, began to strike him again, first in his head, then in his heart, and finally in his reason. At the Cuban embassy in Berlin-Pankow, from the ambassador himself, Hector Rodriguez Lompart, to the rest of the members of the legation, including himself, could not hide their astonishment and dismay when the old embassy teletypewriter burst out syncopatedly with its monotonous and shrill clattering sound, broadcasting the full speech of Fidel Castro in unreserved support of the invasion. The speech was accompanied by a Ministry of Foreign Affairs, MINREX, circular urging all diplomatic personnel not to make any comments other than official ones. Days later, Javier made the most important decision of his life. Taking advantage of his diplomatic status, he fled to West Berlin via Checkpoint Charlie, immediately requesting political asylum and transfer to the United States from the U.S. military authorities. Javier stopped in front of the stone staircase worn by the centuries. He looked back. He saw that the street was empty. He looked at his Omega constellation, which read exactly 4 o'clock in the afternoon. Charlie Brown's collecting agent listened in his headphones to Javier's slightly choppy breathing as he finished climbing the narrow stone staircase, trying to find his way through the centuries-old labyrinth. The smell of damp earth gently entered his lungs, opening the nooks and crannies of memory once again. Finally, he found the tomb of Jehuda ben Bezalel el, Rabbi Lov, that learned theologian, who died at the beginning of the 17th century, and who, according to legend, had been the creator of the golem, a mud creature of the Vltava, to which he gave life, and which he later had to destroy. The tomb of the eminent rabbi was different from the rest, not only for its great size, but also for the great number of stones that covered it. There was no doubt, it was the tomb he was looking for. In the van, an agent expressed his surprise at the idea of making contact with a possible Cuban spy defector in that unusual place. But it had not been as extravagant a decision as the collecting agent thought. Mario Paredes had chosen that place with extreme care. If ever we had to meet without being able to say where, this will be the place precisely here, in front of this tomb, said Paredes, younger and much thinner, to Javier. When together they visited that cemetery in 1964, while he held in his hands one of the stones that covered the tomb of the illustrious rabbi. I take this stone with me, and I will return it. Only if someday we have to meet here, again, it will be our little secret, Paredes added. We will always be friends, whatever happens, Javier added. Mario Paredes and Javier Puig met that same year, when both arrived in Prague through different channels to work at the Cuban embassy, Javier as a diplomat and Paredes as a spy under diplomatic cover. They quickly became friends, and although their lives and tasks within the revolution were very different, they found in literature, cinema, and Czech beer the perfect allies to develop a friendship that, despite later taking opposite directions, seemed to resist the deterioration of time and the wear and tear of political slogans. Many years later, at the home of some American Jewish friends in New York, Javier learned that Paredes had not only stolen a stone, but a wish, and that this wish could not be fulfilled until the stone was returned to its grave. Now he was there again, standing in front of the illustrious rabbi's grave. But where was Mario? What was his old friend up to? A week earlier, he had received a strange call from Paredes in the middle of the night. He had never called him before since he defected to West Berlin, so, to make sure he was talking to him, he asked him a question that only they both knew the answer to. "What's the name I used to call all the girls who went out with you in the 60s? "Is that you?" asked Javier without pronouncing his name, surprised. "Yes, it's me." The second man of Cuban espionage in Prague blurted out without saying his name either. "Miroslava," Javier answered slowly. Then without further ado, once the identity of the person questioned had been verified, tersely, but with a certain nervousness in his voice, Paredes referred to the promise they had made together at the tomb of Rabbi Lo 3 decades ago, without revealing the name of the sage, the place, or the country. "In exactly 1 week, at 4 o'clock in the afternoon, I need to meet you right there. Don't fail me," he added. Knowing that his friend was an important Cuban intelligence agent, aware that he had never contacted him before, concerned about the tone of his voice, and surprised that he knew his secret phone number, Javier Puig immediately contacted his superiors at Langley. After extensive discussions, they authorized him to travel to Prague to find out what Paredes was up to. He remained silent for a few moments as if meditating. He looked around again and saw that he was alone, because from where he was, he could not see the van that he thought would be in one of the surrounding streets. His gaze scrutinized the tomb, and finally he discovered the stone wrapped in brown paper. He unwrapped it carefully. "At the tavern at 21 hours." He read the written message quietly, bringing the microphone he carried hidden in his right hand closer to him. His encrypted voice, converted into analog signals in the form of coded noise, was decoded in the spy van by the sophisticated receivers. After destroying the paper, he placed the stone back where he had found it. "Besides the message, what wish will this stone contain?" he asked himself already on his way to the entrance of the cemetery. "Now at least someone will perhaps be able to make his wish come true, if he is still alive," he thought. He then informed Ray that the tavern to which Paredes was referring could be none other than the U Flecu Brewery. Inside the offices of Cubana de Aviación, Mario Paredes slightly pulled back the old and dirty curtain that covered the glass of the entrance door and watched for a few moments the spy van, parked on the other side of the street. A faint smile appeared on his broad face as he saw Javier Puig walking down one of the deserted streets near the Jewish cemetery. Chapter 2. November 26th. Washington, November 26th morning. Colin Bobolas steered his old Carmen Ghia, which he stubbornly called his veteran car, down I-495, off the Leesburg Pike. At the intersection, he lit his fourth cigarette of the morning. I-495 was usually well backed up with traffic at that hour. He preferred to leave Falls Church early to avoid the car congestion. His tiny blue eyes were almost completely lost behind the thick lenses of his glasses. His doctor had seriously recommended that he stop driving because of his myopia, something that in practice was not so simple to solve for a person like him who had worked all his life outside normal working hours. A couple of weeks ago he had decided, without having discussed it yet with anyone other than Pat, his wife, that once the operation he was working on at the time was over, he would not only stop driving for good, but would also tell the CIA that after almost 30 years of service, he had finally decided to retire. "Once I retire, I will not take a single contract job from the agency, not one," he had solemnly promised Pat, who, even though she knew Colin would not keep his word, had immediately begun making plans to move and buy a townhouse in Virginia. The old house in Falls Church was too big for the two of them after Betty, their daughter, had moved to New York to marry a manager of one of the big hotel chains. Colin had gray hair, was quite small and extremely thin. He was descended from Lithuanian parents who had emigrated to the United States in the early 1920s. He had started working for the agency in the mid-50s at the West Berlin station during Operation Gold, the famous joint US-UK mission that succeeded in tapping the subway telephone communication lines of the Soviet Army quarters in East Berlin through a tunnel that had been built for that purpose. Subsequently, in the mid-60s, it was transferred to Panama. Years later, after a short period in Washington, he was transferred to the Far East, returning to serve in Bolivia and Venezuela. By the end of the 70s, he was station chief in Uruguay and station chief in Mexico, which had become at that time the CIA's main gateway to Cuba. Upon his return from Lisbon in the early 80s, where he also held the position of station chief, he took charge of the UCLA, a group that was commonly called Latin American Resources, in charge of CIA special operations in Latin America. Subsequently, he became the second head of the Latin America Department and finally the head of the Cuba Department. Actually, upon returning from Lisbon, he had been on the verge of retirement in the early 1980s, but when William J. Casey Reagan's campaign manager, a multimillionaire lawyer, a practicing Catholic, and a furious adherent of covert operations, with a past in the espionage world in the post-war era, when he became head in Europe of the U.S. Spy Service, OSS, pre-CIA, took over as director of the agency, only 8 days after Reagan himself moved in for 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, he had asked him to postpone his retirement for a few more years. "Are you going to leave now when it's going to get good?" Casey had asked him with a sly smile as he proposed the position of head of Latin American Resources. Casey died a few years later of a brain tumor, and Colin had decided not to die as his boss at his desk at work. Arriving at the Washington Beltway intersection, he took the lane toward Langley. Langley, Virginia, Central Intelligence Agency HQ, CIA. 26th of November in the morning. Colin showed his senior official's chained metal plate to Langley's main entrance post, who wordlessly raised the barrier. Only the metal gate on the right was open. A few yards further to the left of the entrance was a burned-out bus, which had been used in anti-terrorist security training a week earlier. The Karmann Ghia glided smoothly across the huge parking lot, still deserted at that hour, to finally park in front of the main building of the old headquarters. Finding a good place to park was one of the advantages of arriving early. The other, being able to clear the desk of all those papers that his second-in-command, Ross, brought him daily. But that morning, he knew it would be different. The mountain of papers would have to wait. He'd already told Pat not to count on him for the weekend. After passing the bronze statue of Nathan Hale, America's first spy, silently guarding the entrance to the main building, Colin entered the lobby, where on the marble floor, in the very center, is the famous 5 feet diameter shield, an eagle behind the agency's official coat of arms. "The truth shall set you free," the biblical quotation, engraved on the marble of the entrance, provoked a sly smile in Colleen as he passed the battery of coffee and soft drink machines on the first floor, on which glittered the usual coins that had been forgotten and which no one dared to take. Feared that these petty thefts would be discovered in the routine lie detector checks to which everyone had to submit from time to time. He made his way to the blue elevators in the southwest wing, destined for the third floor where he had his office. After taking off his trench coat and hanging it on the old wooden coat rack he always kept behind the door, Colin lit a cigarette heading for his second's office. Ross greeted him with his customary slight smile, a gesture that gave him that aristocratic air that many colleagues ironically called his little FFV smile, First Families of Virginia, synonymous with the creme de la creme of the American aristocracy. Colin used to add sarcastically in private, when he had had a few drinks too many and was out of earshot of Pat, that his second belonged, moreover, to top it off, to the HYP Club, Harvard, Yale, Princeton, the overname given to CIA officers belonging to more recent generations, with academic studies, but no experience in practical battlefield work. "He solves everything with papers," he used to say. "Good morning, boss. The message from Prague has arrived. You have to pick it up personally," Ross told him, and took a sip of his automatic coffee, carefully placing the plastic cup on the desk, next to a folder with a secret stamp, crossed with the typical red stripe that coded it as material compiled through electronic intelligence, ELINT. "Anything else?" Colin asked in his tired nasal voice. He stubbed out his cigarette as he cast a curious glance at the report his deputy had on the desk. "Yes, but it's not urgent. It's coming from Larnaca, Cyprus," Ross replied. "We'll talk about it later. But now you'd better go and get the report from Prague. You know the deputy director for operations has called a meeting at 10 o'clock. Right, said Colin and retreated in the direction of the green elevators that took him directly to the communications section, where, after the routine check, he was able to pull up the report he had been waiting for from Prague. Back in his office, Colin picked up the clipboard that Pat had bought him in Baden-Baden years before, during one of the few combined vacation and covering trips he had taken with his wife, and opened the sealed envelope. He read carefully the report from the Prague station. He reread a few paragraphs before a smirk revealed his large, gapped teeth. He called Ross on the intercom. Yes? Said Ross curiously as he entered the office. Everything is under control. The first contact with the man from Prague was not direct. It was made through a mailbox, or, to be more exact, with a stone, he said, and smiled teasingly to his second without giving any further explanation. A first physical contact today, expected to take place at 9 o'clock tonight local time, he added, making a few little jumps of joy around the room. Ross looked at him, arching his fine eyebrows. What time is the meeting with the DDO? 10 o'clock, Ross reminded him with butler-like pedantry. Ross did not know the true identity of Major Mario Paredes, whom Colin had dubbed the Man from Prague. In addition to Colin, the real name of the second in command of Cuban intelligence in Prague was known to the DDO, Deputy Director of CIA for Operations, James Clark, two senior chiefs involved in Operation Goofy, and the members of the SCE Monitoring Group. In order to protect Paredes, it was vaguely hinted that he was someone who had very important information about Cuba, without revealing his nationality. What came from Cyprus? Colin asked. Something strange? Ross replied, looking absently out the window at the taste freeze, the flying saucer, the building in which the agency's conference room is located, which everyone knows by that name because of its dome. It's from the cousins received yesterday. A couple of days ago, the British Radio Security Service discovered something in Cyprus that they thought might interest us. Colin gave him an annoyed look. He hated it when Ross wallowed in his explanations, when he went on unnecessarily about something that could be summarized in two sentences. It is a question of an intense traffic of high-speed transmissions detected during these last weeks. According to the British, these transmissions are destined for Syria. And what the hell do we have to do with Syria? The transmissions always coincide with the arrival of CSA, the Czechoslovak airline flight from Prague, and during these transmissions it has been possible to verify the presence of Cuban agents on the plane. Where do these Cubans go later? To Damascus. They use Cyprus as a trampoline to change flights, said Ross, now looking at Colin, who began to walk around the room as he used to do when he was trying to concentrate on something. It has not been possible to decode the content of these broadcasts? Negative, they use OTP codes. The OTP code's one-time pad, a single-use passbook that is combined with a random key in blocks of five-digit codes, difficult to decode, usable only once, to decode cryptograms used by Cuban intelligence. We have to sound out the Institute, send a message to Tel Aviv, but don't drop any garments unnecessarily. Understood? Ross nodded. Colin didn't like the idea of getting Mossad mixed up in all this, but he knew that the Israelis were going to get their noses in the game sooner or later. Colin entered the meeting room of DDO James Clark, located in the C Wing on the 16th floor of the CIA headquarters building in Langley. Also seated at the oval mahogany table were Phil Gerber, head of the SE division, responsible for all CIA operations in the denied areas, as the agency called the territories of the Soviet Union and its satellite countries in Eastern Europe, and Howard O'Neill, National Intelligence Officer, NIO, for Latin America, an experienced agency analyst. The NIOs are responsible for a geographic territory and also prepare the prognosis. O'Neill was considered one of the CIA's most experienced analysts on Cuba and an old friend of Colin. Clark, who was talking on the phone, standing at the large window overlooking a neighboring forest, turned his head slightly and gave a friendly wave to Colin, who returned the greeting as he sat across from his other two colleagues. Gerber looked up slightly from his papers to greet him, casting him a scrutinizing glance. Colin returned the greeting, including O'Neill in passing, who nodded slightly with a slight smile. Gerber returned the gesture with his customary coolness, glancing sideways at his Cartier with that smug attitude which appeared to be discreet, but which in reality was a calculated gesture he often used to let his interlocutors know that their time was limited and that he had other more important things to do. Colin took some papers out of his briefcase and began to arrange them carefully on the table, at the same time as he looked around the room, as if trying to measure the distance that separated him from the other three men. The atmosphere was tense. On top of all the papers, he finally placed a folder with the red label, Top Secret, and a name, Operation Goofy. The collapse of the Berlin Wall weeks before, and the imminent fall of the Czechoslovak communist regime, had contributed to the questioning from the beginning of Operation Goofy, the name given to the possible defection of Paredes, in Prague, and his meeting with Puig. It was feared that the meeting could pose some danger to the delicate maneuver that the CIA was carrying out at that very moment in Czechoslovakia, aimed at accelerating the collapse of the communist regime in that country as well. Above all, to make sure that the forces aligned with the West, and above all with the United States, aligned with the dissidents led by Havel, seized power before Moscow could take control again, placing the communist reformists aligned with Gorbachev, or using Alexander Dubček, the leader of the Prague Spring in 1968, considered by the CIA as a political corpse. Colin had advocated giving the go-ahead for Puig's trip to Prague, aware that such an opportunity to penetrate the sanctuary of Cuban intelligence at such an important time had not presented itself since DGI Major Florentino Aspilagas defected years before, and probably would not present itself again for a long time. The deputy director for operations had authorized only the first phase of the operation, that is to say, the dispatch of the contract agent, Javier Puig, to Prague, to make a first contact with the alleged Cuban spy defector, nothing more. Those had been explicitly the conditions that James Clark had imposed. That morning, the meeting had been called to evaluate, discuss, and decide whether the Prague operation should continue or not, since the meeting between Paredes and Puig had been postponed, and the political situation in Czechoslovakia was extremely delicate at that time. Gerber, who from the beginning had been against giving the green light to the operation that the Cuban department had begun in what he considered part of his own territory, returned to the reading of the last-minute reports in the hope that he could find new arguments solid enough to stop the operation. The fact that direct contact with the probable Cuban deserter in the old Jewish cemetery had not been made was something Gerber regarded as a good argument for demanding that the operation be called off. The head of the Soviet East European Division, SE, claimed that the Cuban agent evidently had second thoughts, or worse, that his attitude might be proof that the Cubans were trying to carry out a provocative operation against the CIA to hinder the fall of communism in Czechoslovakia. He had also hinted that the Cuban agent might be a double agent, that the DGI wanted to infiltrate the CIA for disinformation. Colin, for his part, had steadfastly refused to call the Cuban spy a defector, or suspected defector, claiming that it was not certain that the Cuban agent wanted to defect, which meant that there was a possibility that he might become a double agent. He also tried to undercut Gerber's insinuations that Paredes might be participating in some operational game to infiltrate the CIA. Colin had expressed in detail throughout the last few meetings with the Deputy Director for Operations, DDO, and Gerber, that the approach had to take place very carefully, precisely so as not to destroy the possibility of him becoming a double agent. "It's an opportunity we simply cannot waste," he had said at the last meeting, during which the decision had been made to authorize the first meeting. At that meeting, Gerber had defended his views on the grounds that at that time, the CIA had a lot of balls in the air, not only in Czechoslovakia, but in other communist countries in Europe, and that Operation Goofy contributed absolutely nothing to what was going on at that time in that part of the world. On the contrary, some important resources are diverted at crucial moments to give cover to this operation, which, on the other hand, if it fails, could even harm the operations that the SE division is currently conducting in the denied areas, he had said. Cuba was for Gerber something marginal at the time. A piece that would fall, like Mongolia or Bulgaria, by its own weight, once the Soviet Empire disintegrated. Castro is no longer a military danger to the hemisphere. "You should read the latest reports coming to us from the Pentagon," he had said sarcastically to Colin in one of the earlier meetings, referring to the latest reports from Ana Belén Montes, a military intelligence analyst at the Defense Intelligence Agency, DIA, an expert on Cuban military affairs. If I were you, I'd be a lot more concerned about who's going to take power in a few months in Cuba after Castro, he had told Clark during a personal interview. Days before the deputy director for operations authorized the start of Operation Goofy. Clark hung up the phone and took a seat, apologizing for the delay. The CIA operational chief was a man in his 50s, with a good physique, black hair with a few gray hairs, and medium height. Behind him, he had an extensive service record like the other three men seated around his desk. Station chief in the 70s, in Tripoli, Cambodia, and China. At the end of that decade, he had also served as head of the powerful SE division. Phil Gerber stopped reading. He took off his glasses and quickly sorted through the papers, adopting a wait-and-see attitude, as if giving the impression that he was in no way a leading actor, but merely a spectator. He was a quiet man, known for his bad temper and his terror of viruses and infections, but a great connoisseur of his area, specifically the Soviet Union. He had previously led the internal investigation into the case of Vitaj Yurchenko, the KGB's chief of operations in the United States and Canada, who in 1985 defected, but who months later disappeared, evading the custody of his security officer at a restaurant in Georgetown, only to reappear days later at the Soviet embassy in Washington. During a hurried and tumultuous press conference in which, in front of the astonished gaze of journalists, he told the unbelievable story that he had been kidnapped by the CIA months earlier, but had miraculously managed to finally escape from his kidnappers. Gerber had studied and analyzed the reasons why the CIA had failed to gain the confidence of that important Soviet agent, who, after defecting and even turning in a former CIA agent working for the KGB, Edward Lee Howard, had decided to return voluntarily to his country. The SE division had undergone major changes when Gerber took over its leadership. Subsequently, he was able to manipulate the KGB favorably in some of the operations that led to the dismantling of the conservative communist regimes in Eastern Europe. He had collaborated, for example, with the British Intelligence Service when the Soviet double agent Oleg Gordievsky, then KGB resident in London, had prepared with the help of the SIS the reports for Gorbachev, prior to the Secretary General's visit to the UK in 1984. These reports, it is said, played an important role during the summit meeting between Mikhail Gorbachev and Margaret Thatcher, a meeting that definitely contributed to the major political changes between East and West in the late 1980s. Clark asked Colin to report briefly on the progress of the operation. Colin detailed how the operation had developed. Without putting too much emphasis on his voice, he ended by saying that there was nothing negative to indicate that Operation Goofy should be suspended. In approximately 4 hours, our man will be able to make his first direct contact with the subject once the initial approach has been made. Now he only awaits our authorization, Colin added succinctly. The subject, in my opinion, contrary to what Gerber has expressed here previously, is careful, which means, according to our interpretation, that he does not wish to burn his ships in a first encounter. Colin cast a piercing, distrustful glance at Gerber through his round, thickly lensed glasses, which relentlessly dwarfed his intense blue eyes turned into icy, tiny dots. We only have one problem, if it is decided to go ahead with the operation, Colin said, and Clark looked up over his glasses curiously. We need a second unit from Special Intelligence Collection Group, in addition to the follow-on group that had previously been approved, he added, looking back at Clark. Gerber furrowed his eyebrows and looked down at his papers, dodging Clark's gaze, which was riveted on him, searching for a response to Colin's comment. This damn Colin constantly playing dirty, he thought. Colin was forcing him to get defensive. Operations involving the use of mobile spy units in countries belonging to the SE division required the special permission of the operational chief. Only James Clark could give that order. Operation Goofy is taking place in Czechoslovakia, at a time when that country is experiencing a very special situation, Gerber explained, looking at Clark with an imploring gesture. A situation that is not yet under control, he added, with a discerning glance at Colin, who chose to ignore it. That second monitoring group that Colin has asked for is busy with another, even more important job. It is the unit that watches over the head of the KGB's Prague office, General Grushko, who, as you know, is the coordinator of Operation Wedge, launched last November 17th. He paused a moment and, realizing that Colin and O'Neill were probably unaware of the KGB operation in Prague, added, "Operation Wedge is a plot that has been launched by the KGB in Prague. Operation Wedge is a KGB gold trail plot to bring down the unreliable Milos Jakes and put in his place a leadership unconditional to current Kremlin policy. Change things up a bit to leave everything the same," he said sarcastically, looking at Colin, who dodged his gaze again. Clark nodded patiently, and O'Neill hinted to the DDO that he wanted to say something, but Gerber took no notice and continued. "It is no secret, at least to those of us sitting around this table, that Gorbachev has tried, with mixed results, to dismantle some of the conservative communist governments in Eastern Europe," said the head of the SE division. "First, because these governments refused to accept his policy of glasnost and perestroika. Second, because if he did not finish them off, they would finish him off." He paused artificially to add emphasis to his last words. "In East Germany, the situation got out of hand and the people tore down the wall. Now, in Czechoslovakia, they seem to be going the same way," he whispered with the assurance of someone who knows very well what he is saying. "The changes the Russians intend to make have also come too late in Czechoslovakia. It is in the midst of this difficult situation, and taking into account our limited resources, that the Cuba Department is asking us for more help than we have already given it, and which, moreover, from the very beginning, we have described as risky. It is absurd." "What do you think, Howard?" Clark asked, trying to balance Gerber's judgment. O'Neill's gaze wandered slightly until it settled on a neutral point above the heads of Phil Gerber and James Clark, trying to give the impression of impartiality. He knew Gerber was on the defensive, and he didn't want to stir up his bad mood unnecessarily. "The situation in Czechoslovakia is extremely delicate. Phil is right. No one doubts that. There is a power struggle going on, and naturally, if we can help tip the balance to the right side, we won't hesitate to do so." He pushed back his hair with his fingers as if trying to put his thoughts in order. "An opportunity like this doesn't come along every year. This is all true." He took off his glasses and looked at the papers in front of him. "Likewise, this operation, which has been baptized with the name of Goofy, is much more important than what the SE believes." He observed Gerber with a penetrating look. "We must not forget that Cuba is not only a Soviet aircraft carrier stationed 90 miles from the United States, but also a sworn enemy of the United States. Castro has shown many times before that he is astute enough to get himself out of really difficult situations. Even in the event of the demise of the Soviet Union, I am not among those who believe that Castro will throw in the towel as Honecker did. The island is his hacienda, and he has total control. Moreover, I am convinced that he can still give us serious headaches. When the tiger is mortally wounded, it is usually more dangerous. Castro has nowhere to go and is going to fight to the end," he said, dropping the last word softly. "But what everyone is most concerned about at the moment is whether or not the Prague operation should continue." The analyst sighed deeply. "To predict whether the operation will succeed or not, and more importantly, whether its failure can have a negative impact on the development of events in Czechoslovakia, that's what it's all about. That's what it's all about, isn't it?" he added, looking at Gerber with a smile that showed understanding. "I would say that this operation, let's say the recruitment of a Cuban agent, and the events in Prague, are two separate events, which, although they have the same scenario, take place on two different levels, two dimensions which have no reason to meet," he said, making a small explanatory gesture with his hands, which ended in a pout as if asking for understanding. "The problem is, in my opinion, in the logistical practical aspect. Does the success of Operation Goofy depend on the number of agents available in the field?" the NIO for Latin America asked thoughtfully. "That is the question we must ask ourselves. I don't question Colin's calculations, but I have confidence in our man. He is a talent of great qualities, especially suited to this operation. I am inclined to think that the success of it depends to a large extent on him, and not on the number of people we have working in the field. The number of agents involved in this operation in Prague must be reduced to a minimum due to the situation previously exposed by Gerber. He looked quickly at the head of the denied areas with some complicity in his eyes. But that doesn't mean that the personnel should be reduced to the point of making impossible the work of monitoring and communications, something extremely important for our evaluation of the operation, and of course, for the safety of our talent. He turned his gaze to Colin. And finally, can the failure of the operation jeopardize the other SE operations in Czechoslovakia at this time? He paused for a moment, addressing the DDO. My answer is no. What's more, I think our man in Prague could be of great help to us at this time. He turned to Gerber again and stared at him. You, Phil, who personally led the internal investigation in the Yurchenko case, should know better than anyone else how important it is to give an enemy agent who is thinking of collaborating or defecting all the support he needs at such a crucial time in his life. Isn't that right? There was silence, interrupted only by the light, nervous tapping of Gerber's pipe on the folder. So what's your conclusion, Howard? Clark asked. Approve the second phase of the operation, but without the augmentation of a second SCE unit, which Colin has requested, O'Neill replied, turning again to Gerber, who dodged his gaze. The rest of the operation will probably not take place in Czechoslovakia. Therefore, it is not your headache, Phil, nor is it a matter for discussion now. We will talk about it later, once we have the results of the second phase in our hands. It is first and foremost a matter for the Cuba department. Clark coughed slightly. Gerber meticulously placed his pipe on the table next to the sting packet in protest, as Clark had forbidden smoking in meetings since he had taken over as chief of operations, and remained silent. Operation Goofy is important, no doubt about it. Otherwise, we wouldn't be gathered here now, and so are the events in Czechoslovakia, of course. So are the events in Czechoslovakia, obviously. Everything that's going on now is important, historic, Clark said, and the others shook their heads in the affirmative. But our resources are limited. That's no secret to anyone. Before we make a decision, I want to ask two questions, one to Colin and the other to Phil. Colin sat upright in his seat and Gerber remained impassive. With current resources, is there any calculation of probabilities for the success or failure of the operation, Colin? Colin quickly searched through his papers. 60 in favor, 40 against. Is there really a danger that if the operation fails, it could adversely affect developments in Czechoslovakia? Clark asked Gerber. There is no calculation of probabilities because there are several operations we have going on, and it is difficult to make a comparative estimate under these circumstances, the head of the SE replied. But there is a danger that, for example, if all this is, let us say, a provocation by the Cubans, a question we have discussed before, the turbulence that would form around a scandal of these dimensions could obviously affect the other operations in Czechoslovakia. They could take advantage of such a scandal. Who do you mean? Clark asked. To the conservative communist elements, to all those who are against Gorbachev, Gerber replied. One of our sources has informed us that a coup d'etat or something similar is brewing to overthrow Gorbachev. Clark nodded and made a note on his block. O'Neill raised his index finger slightly, asking for the word again. There is always a risk, but statistically speaking, the chances of success are greater than failure, O'Neill added. Otherwise, we wouldn't exist as an organization. If it weren't, we wouldn't exist as an organization, would we? Clark thought for a moment before finally answering. Okay, Colin, you're going to have to make do with current resources. The previously approved resources will not be touched. Otherwise, the green light to the second phase of the operation. Thank you, gentlemen, Clark said, getting up from his chair and putting his papers in order. Gerber pressed hard on the tobacco he had slipped into his pipe with his thumb. Colin had deftly diverted the discussion to a secondary problem, the number of special intelligence gathering units, in order to gain approval for the second phase of the operation. Chapter 3, November 25th and 26th. Prague, November 25th, hours later. The woman continued talking imperturbably on the old Bakelite telephone, ignoring Javier, who absentmindedly continued looking at the few handcrafted objects in the store. The dusty, almost empty shop windows gave the impression that the merchandise served more of a decorative function. A few bohemian crystal glasses, which had managed to capture Javier's interest, were probably the only valuable objects on display for sale, survivors of the cataclysm of the planned economy. When the sales clerk hung up the phone, Javier tried to tell her in German and English that he wanted to buy the four crystal glasses, but the woman, who only spoke Czech, shrugged her shoulders without making the slightest effort to understand him. Only when Javier finally resorted to mimicry, taking the four crystal glasses from the shelf and placing them on the counter with a resolute gesture, while paying with the old crowns, the woman, without saying a word, slowly wrapped them in a thick waxed paper that she covered with a brown string of strange and penetrating odor. Javier, out of pure courtesy, before leaving the store, thanked her in her language, Dikau, to which the woman with a surprising smile replied, Budzdrav, goodbye. As Javier stepped out onto the street, he looked again at the wall of the building on the corner, almost completely covered by a huge sign of the Soviet Agricultural Machinery Export Company, Traktorn Export, immediately discovering the white chalk stripe that he had previously searched for without success. It was the sign indicating that Langley had given the order to continue the operation. With the huge waxed packet with the four cups under his arm, he headed for the nearby hotel. A short distance away, almost at his heels, the members of the tracking party, like true bloodhounds, continued to track his route, making sure that no one was following him. Inside the spy van, parked in a lonely parking lot, the technician collector prepared the final details, adjusting the electronic listening devices. Inside the vehicle, in addition to the two regular technicians, was Rick Malloy, the operations field manager. Malloy was a man of about 35, athletic, and with refined manners that contrasted with his physiognomy. The agent sent a coded message to the communications center, located in a mobile unit in West Germany, near the Czechoslovakian border, to indicate that Javier had been informed and that the operation was underway again. The 100-year-old clock in the Ufleku brewery at 11 Kremenkova Street struck 9 o'clock in the evening. On St. Wenceslas Square, 600,000 Czechoslovaks again demanded that Dubček be their president. Inside in the tavern, people toasted the fall of the communist regime. In the largest of the halls, dancers and singers were finishing a vaudeville. The waiters, at a pace and speed uncommon in the communist countries of Eastern Europe, continued to serve the huge pitchers of frothy black beer brewed in the cellars of the emblematic place. During his years at the Cuban embassy in Prague, Javier had made Ufleku the center of his social life. There he had met the Cuban poet Roberto Padilla, who in those years had Prague as his base of operations when he worked as managing director of Kubar Timpex, the foreign trade company dedicated to the export and import of art and cultural articles, and another poet, the Salvadoran Roque Dalton, who in those years worked in the international communist magazine Problemas de la Paz y el Socialismo, Peace and Socialism Problems, and who also frequented the Ufleku, almost always equipped with his ramshackle tape recorder with which he recorded conversations of the parishioners. From those recordings came his book, Taberna y Otros Lugares. Javier, about 10 years younger than Padilla and Dalton, felt very well in the company of those two excellent poets. With them he shared, besides his fondness for dark beer, his passion for poetry and for Kafka, whose labyrinthine narrations he explored with Padilla and Mario Paredes in those idyllic gatherings. Prague was full of memories of a time when Javier was happy in spite of everything, and the Ufleku was the center of those remembrances. A feeling of emptiness came over him as he looked through the crowd for Paredes. Nothing was the same as in the mid and late 60s, when, despite the doubts, there was still illusion and hope. It was in that decisive 1968 when Javier decided to seek asylum in the United States after the invasion of Russian and Warsaw Pact troops, and Padilla, who had returned to Havana shortly before, published his book Fuera del Juego, Out of the Game. Despite having won the National Poetry Prize, the book of poems was labeled by the regime's cultural carcinogens as counter-revolutionary. it was the first act of what later became known worldwide as the Padilla case. Another of the many reasons that later strengthened his decision to desert the ranks of the revolution. Javier stood at the front door of the tavern, watching the patrons sitting at the long tables singing and swaying back and forth like a huge human pendulum. Mario was nowhere to be seen. He checked the time with his Omega and the Ufleku watch and decided to enter the place. Without haste, he went through the different rooms of the brewery, looking for the second man of the Cuban intelligence in Prague, among the public. He recognized two of the members of the monitoring team, who had previously taken their positions. A middle-aged woman with a few extra kilos and a totally expressionless face was sitting near the door, eating a rolled fillet of beef, accompanied with klednike balls, flour dumplings, and a man of about 35, with small round glasses who was calmly reading the Rue des Pravo while drinking a beer. He decided to sit at one of the side tables that he found empty, near the entrance door. From there he could watch the entrance and also the premises. A waiter, pale and thin as a corpse, apparently as drunk as his clientele, approached him and Javier ordered a pivo, beer. He felt a certain pleasure in recalling the sparse Czech vocabulary he had not had a chance to practice until that moment. He imagined seeing Roque Dalton among the parishioners, laughing, bony, snub-nosed, skin as pale and yellowish as wax, armed with that old tape recorder that always accompanied him, listening between beers to the conversations of students, workers, and soldiers that he had previously recorded for his book. Javier, Eastern Europe is not the model of socialism that I wish for Latin America. It is a world that sooner or later will burst because of its own contradictions, the Salvadoran poet used to say, when they were engaged in one of the many political discussions they used to have in that same place, and that Javier remembered while impatiently waiting for other ghosts of Prague's past. Roque, the revolutionary, the idealist follower of Che, vilely assassinated by his own comrades in cause, only 4 days before his 40th birthday. Javier ruminated, resting his eyes on a nearby table where the small group of friends used to sit, 21 years ago, and confusing the faces of those present with the faces of the past. Dalton's murder in 1975 had surprised Javier in Paris. His crime shocked him, not only because he remembered him as a good friend from the times of Prague, and because he knew his revolutionary honesty, but also because his horrendous death, as Julio Cortázar called it, had been one of the blackest chapters of Latin American revolutionary history. Dalton was never heard from again after he left for Cuba, disappointed with Soviet-style socialism, inspired by Che, and ready to surrender to the armed struggle in his native country, precisely when Javier decided to desert in Berlin. A tribunal of the Popular Liberation Army guerrilla group, which Dalton had joined upon his return to El Salvador, condemned him to death. Poor Dalton, to die murdered by his own comrades. Accused of being a CIA agent, thought Javier, who was brought back to reality, when he heard the hoarse and opaque voice of the waiter, who asked him to pay in cash for the pitcher of black beer that had just been placed on the table, next to a folded piece of paper that he lightly indicated with his index finger. Javier took a long sip, wiping with his hand the mustache of foam that formed above his lips. Putting the tankard back on the table, he discreetly picked up the paper which he opened in his lap, protected by the table. "Take the first cab out and ask to go to Hradčany Castle," she read quickly. "Mario has taken every possible precaution," he thought, taking out a handkerchief with which he wiped his forehead. It was the signal to the tracking group that he had made preliminary but not definite contact. He hurried his beer and stood up, casting a sidelong glance at the agent who, sitting near the door, had already alerted the tracking unit on the street, split between the van and a Skoda, the other vehicle belonging to the group. In the spy van, Rick's face turned red with anger. "Attention! Do not lose sight of the hunter. He will probably have to move again to another place," he said. The technician repeated the orders to the rest of the monitoring group. Javier left the restaurant. A cab driver who, apparently like so many others, had taken a break from his work to have a beer at the Ufleku, came up to him. "Taxi, mister?" Javier nodded and entered the car without saying a word. From the van, Rick gave orders to the Skoda to follow the taxi. They in the van, in turn, would follow the Skoda by radio and at a distance. The taxi started up and Javier read the paper again before shredding it. The driver, a somewhat small and chubby man, asked in a disinterested tone in English, "Where to, mister?" "To Radcani Castle." The chauffeur looked at him through the rearview mirror, and a mischievous smile appeared on his lips. Javier realized that the driver was watching him. The man pulled his cap back and left his black hair uncovered. It was then that Javier was able to discover Mario Paredes' face through the rearview mirror. "How are you, Javier? How are you doing?" "Mario, what a bastard you are! How can you do this to me? I hardly recognized you. You're older and fatter." "Time does not pass in vain, but you keep pretty well," Paredes pointed out, and they both laughed, and a mutual look of sympathy and friendship crossed between the two of them. "How many cars do your people have to follow us?" "I don't know, I think two," answered Javier. "Then let's try to get rid of these guys in the Skoda first. This party is only for two," he said, and quickly turned down an opposite street, immediately crossing the next one, seconds before a streetcar managed to pass it. The Skoda was forced to brake, and when the streetcar crossed, the cab had already disappeared. "We lost contact with the hunter at the Deluha Trida. Streetcar stop on Revolution Street," said the man sitting next to the driver of the Skoda. At the van, Rick gave orders to continue trying to locate the cab. Turning to the collector technician, he asked, "Does Javier have his transmitter working?" "No, it's off." "What about your tracking device?" The collecting technician examined his instruments before shaking his head negatively. "We instructed him to use the transmitter only when physical contact occurred, and the tracking device only in case of danger, and that only for short periods of time. It is clear that he is not in danger." "Let's wait a little longer," Rick shook his head affirmatively. "Anyway, there's something strange about that cab suddenly disappearing. Try to get some information." The dispatcher reported shortly afterwards that the license plate did not belong to any cab, but that it was impossible at this stage to determine its origin. "That son of a bitch Cuban beat us to it. Now it's all up to Javier," said Rick. Early morning, November 26th, Stockholm Archipelago, midnight, Sweden. The ferry making the crossing between the island of Åland and Stockholm passed the Landsort Lighthouse on the island of Oya, one of the first islands of the Stockholm Archipelago. In the ship's discotheque only, a few drunken Swedes were still dancing, although the music had stopped more than an hour before. On the bridge, the officer of the watch and a couple of sailors were holding their course. The radar on the Vikings line's Mariella had detected nothing abnormal. Its greenish beam showed what it was supposed to show. It was a quiet night, as usual, boring. So perhaps no one noticed that behind the wake left by the ship, a periscope rose just a few inches above sea level. It was precisely in the shadow of the ship's radar, and therefore invisible. It was a cold, black night, and the cloudy sky hid the stars and a waning quarter moon. Silently, the submarine moved away from the ship and into the archipelago, but its movements were not detected by the Mariella's radar either. It was a whiskey-class submarine belonging to the Soviet Navy, a rather old model manufactured during World War II, which surfaced between two small islets using the channel that separated them. It was very difficult for the Swedish Navy to detect with its radars a submarine that used its own islands as camouflage to hide. That had long been the technique that the Spetsnaz, the GRU's special operations troops, had used to get their agents into Sweden. A rubber dinghy was launched into the sea, and four figures dressed in black suits and masks paddled silently to shore. A black Dodge van with tinted windows, hidden on a small road very close to the shore, flashed its lights at the rubber boat, which responded by sending another signal with a flashlight. The four figures already on land turned the boat into a small lump in seconds and buried it in the sand behind some pine trees, then headed for the vehicle. "The submarine is submerged again, disappearing into the depths of the Baltic." "Welcome to Stockholm," said the driver in Spanish with a strong Chilean accent. "Greetings and thank you, comrade," a woman's voice also replied in Russian-accented Spanish. The Chilean was surprised, but said nothing. He put the van in gear and headed for a country road. Inside the vehicle, the Russians began to take off their black hoods and rubber suits. Among them were two women, one blonde and rather slender, who had been the one to answer in Spanish, the other with short reddish hair and broad shoulders. The three men remained silent, and only the reflection of the dashboard lights helped the driver to discover through the rearview mirror four hard faces with vacant stares. Prague, November 26th, after midnight. Prague was in party mood and people were in the streets singing, drinking and celebrating the triumph of the Sametova Revolution, the Velvet Revolution. A day later, a general strike finally put an end to 44 years of communism and Soviet domination. Javier returned to his hotel after midnight in a cab. He could hardly walk and had to lean on the bellboy to take the elevator. Rick, who had decided to sleep at the embassy, was awakened minutes later by the duty officer. "Your hunter has returned to the hotel drunk, drugged, or maybe both," the officer told him in a dry tone. Rick went to the bathroom, followed by the officer, who continued to mumble details of Javier's arrival. He urinated eagerly. "When did he arrive?" he asked, zipping up the zipper. "About 10 minutes ago. The bellboy had to help him, because he was falling." Rick stuck his head in the stream of cold water from the basin to wake himself up. "Please find Charlie," he said. Charlie Allen, the second man from the CIA station in Prague, arrived 20 minutes later and quickly made his way to the communication center on the top floor of the building where Rick was waiting for him. Still sleepy, he pulled a coffee from the automatic, gesturing to Rick that he needed to wake up with the drink first. He was a man in his 30s, with tortoiseshell-rimmed glasses and round lenses that accentuated a certain intellectual air about him. "What's the problem?" he asked, blowing into the plastic cup he held in his well-manicured hands. "That cafe is crap," said the officer on duty. But Charlie paid no attention to him. "We must make immediate contact with the hunter. He has returned in bad shape. We don't know if he has been drugged. He arrived 35 minutes ago and it looks like he's in his room," said Rick. Charlie took a sip and found out that the coffee was terribly bad. "We need to know what happened. They may have drugged him, taken all the information out of him," Rick added with concern. "We can't make direct contact with him in any way, you know. Those are orders," he added, tossing the plastic cup with coffee into the trash can. "All contacts with him have to be made outside of Czechoslovakia. I'm sorry. Those are the rules. There's nothing we can do, Rick." "Well, you don't have to say it again, I know," replied Rick, visibly irritated by Charlie's intransigent position. "It is necessary to inform the station chief," said the duty officer, who was a member of the OS, the department in charge of internal security at the agency. "It is not necessary. I am directly responsible for this operation," said Rick, trying to persuade the security officer. There was silence, and the three men realized that they had reached an impasse in the conversation. "I think I have the solution," said Charlie. Rick looked at him with surprise. "There is a Czech doctor who sometimes works for us, but he is not an agent or talent, someone we use from time to time. He could go to the hotel and examine our man without arousing suspicion and without violating the rules." "Is it possible?" he asked the officer.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.